easy here to kill. Alrighty, ladies. So let us see. Tarantula Gaming versus Shox. From the draft perspective, I would say that. It's actually pretty hard. Yeah, it's hard. I think I kind of favor Shox still, though, because. Even though Tarantula Gaming's, like, heroes, they have a lot of teamfight power, they look decently strong, but they don't really have any good way to initiate, and, like, even if Loligo gets like, an early blink on the Nyx, Nyx is not really a good hero to initiate with in many cases, whereas you have, like, a Batrider inside of Shox, you have a lot of, you know, you have your magic immunity Juggernaut, always an annoying hero to work with. For the, like, big clump in a teamfight, you have the Warlock with the Golem plus Fatal Bonds, which you always have to be a little bit afraid of. And Underlord for defending towers early game against the Terrorblade is most likely going to be one of the more useful offlaners you can fit. And like I talked about, it is indeed going to be a Batrider support. So this is a Batrider that is moving around and being annoying on the map more than anything. Whereas Dale, he's going to be like the big core in the lane. And well, an Oracle is not really a scary support against this kind of duo. You have like that laning harassment slash prowess of the Batrider just spamming napalm and hitting you. And Dale, you know, the aura, the spam of the Firestorm to make sure they can't push early. Depending on how much tower value you can get with this Terrorblade early game, I kind of feel like that's like the main concern that Shox have to worry about. If they can stop this Terrorblade from getting early income by getting towers, then I think that draft is going to be a lot smoother to execute. And we'll see Loligo in the top lane. This is hiding himself in the trees. He is looking for a level 1 pull just to make his life a little bit sweeter. You need to be careful though, as well, I guess they don't really have the best way of punishing him unless the Batrider is up here and shows himself and they get like a lot of spam with that napalm. He is one of the only heroes that can continue chasing forever. And okay, it actually looks like, you know, the early ward from the Nyx Assassin is going to pay off. He spots out that they are making a rotation and he's going to be like, okay, well, I'll go take this rune. I'll go back, pull the wave, I'll have a fun life. We do have the Warlock spotting him out finally here, so he will not be able to at least pull the wave, but, you know, still worth it. They thought they could get away with getting a free rune, but in the end it's just going to be a traded rune more than anything. Alright, mid lane we do have the Mirana fighting up against the Batrider, fighting up against the Jug. This is a matchup that's definitely favored for the Juggernaut just because of, you know, hit-wise, animation and all that good stuff. It's a lot easier for the Jug to do damage to the creeps. It does take a little arrow to the face, but that's just tanking it so the range creep doesn't get taken down. That's always something you have to do against Mirana in the matchup. The Mirana only wins the matchup when you start, like, you know, pushing. sure that the range creep survives for as long as possible. Unless we bottom him, go to the bat rock, going a little bit deep here, as he actually does fall down two artists on this tower, popping his metamorphosis level 1. But that's a very standard thing to do, just, you know, get it off cooldown whenever it is up and ready to go. Just get some kind of pressure done, even if it's just for harassment, even if it's just to secure yourself the first couple of creep waves. It doesn't really matter, you should always try and use it as much as possible. You know, worst case scenario, you pop it and the only thing you get is this laning control where you can deny every single sweep. So that's also fine. They will trade some hits with the Terror, but this guy doesn't really care too much with that Atrophy aura. He doesn't have a fear in his life. The Terror Blade doesn't do that much damage, especially now with the Metamorphosis being on cooldown. So now it is all about, you know, turning that one death into just a lot of control in this lane. They are 3 versus 2, so far so good. The next assassin in the top lane is leeching as much as he can. He's level 2 for the time being. But as long as they can control the lane, it should be nice. Saini is also level 2. They have been able to pull a little bit. And Lolico is going to take a lot of damage here as he's going for the rune. He wants to just sneak that up as, you know, free rune grab. Why not? TP himself away and then, you know, everything is fine. He can go back to his own rune and pick that up as well. So that's going to be very close to a free level if he does that. But now the Warlock will move in and take that. So I guess they just trade evenly. Alright, what else is happening? So let's see, bottom lane, Terrorblade. Just farming and farming and farming, hitting creeps. Not much changing the two heroes. Mid lane is incredibly even as well, as they're both sitting on roughly 12 assets. We have the safe laners also doing evenly, 10 versus 8 off laners. It's the Underlord who's winning this matchup for the time being, sitting on 6 lasses. Whereas the next assassin is a big fat Seer. He's just leeching experience. He doesn't care about getting creep hits. And Saini is definitely not making his life that easy, as we do have the continuous spam of Shadow Ward, the shooting daggers and whatnot. This is not a lane where, sure, Nyx is a hero that has a lot of regen, but you know, there's a limit to the insanity of regen, right? There is a limit. Alright, and what else is happening, ladies? So, on the Lord level 3, Batrat level 3 as well, Nyx is level 3, so overall it looks like Shax is actually having a very, very nice time in the lanes. You can see they have a 500 net, what's it called, experience lead right now. Tantula is leading when it comes to net worth, but just getting these levels seems like it's going to pay off very nicely. You can even have the Batrat just go back into the jungle and farm up some camps, as he is having enough levels to do that now, so I feel like if Shax just, you know, play it safe, they don't lose any heroes, and they just try and maximize their farming in the game, then it's going to be a very, very nice laning stage to get out of. As punishing these lanes, like, how are you going to punish anything? The best lane you have to kill would be the Underlord for the side of Tarantula Gaming. You can't really kill the Jug, he will just spin away from any kind of setup you use, so unless he takes a 5-second arrow to the face, that is very unlikely. The Nyx Assassin can't do too much before he's level 6 himself, and you can see he bought an Iron Talon. That lane is not too much fun. It's only a dual lane, but it's one of those dual lanes you really don't want to be in, as the PA is spamming spells on you 24-7, the Warlock will continuously spam his Shadow Word like every time he gets a chance to, so it makes sense that the Nyx will just go back and, you know, try and get some lasses in the camps instead. And let's see, Batrider moving himself back as well. Maybe we'll stack some ancient. He's gonna stack one of the easier camps. Makes sense as well. You can stack this one and farm that. It's probably more value to do that, honestly, but he doesn't have level 2 Firefly. If he went like 1-0-2 instead, I think if you just napalm this like 10 times, you can farm it. But it takes a while. It's like, you know, farming ancients with Batrat is possible now, but without levels, it's not that easy. And I'll do a game bottom lane trying to survive here. As we talked about this time, this is the one lane that can get kills. They will X mark him back, they will nuke him down, they will get the kill now. We do have the Batrat coming in, we do have the Fatal Bonds ticking up, as well as the Batrat is slowly burning everyone up. And he will get a kill on the Keeper of the Light. The Keeper of the Light will be taken down. And I'm not really too sure what that nuke was about from Cybernet, but I guess he tried to keep himself safe. Not like that happened, actually. We have the Batarang going in deep, but trying to get a kill there as well. We do have Ardis not being gone by Sany. As Sany, we do have that magic stick keeping him alive. Terrorblade still surviving. He does have a healing cell available as well, so this is just going to take him down low. He will pop his cell, he will survive. But it is going to be a 2-for-2 trade-off, as I think Sanguine Sharks will be happy with that. The Warlock gets a little bit more experience on the lane, and the Batarang, you know, he came in, he got a lot of levels with that. He's suddenly level 4, sitting on Tranquil Boots plus Windlace. Dale dying there is maybe not the best thing in the world, but you know, it's an Underlord, it's a hero that can farm very easily, whether it's in the lane or away from the lane. So all in all, Tarantula Gaming, they will not be too satisfied with that matchup. Plus, they had to use the Metamorphosis there, so that is going to be 1 minute with a less value for the Terrorblade. You can see farm-wise, Terrorblade is almost on half the amount of lasses as the PA is having complete free farm, whereas the Terrorblade is getting a little bit contested. Alright, guys. Looking solid for the side of Shark. 1,000 net worth and experience lead mid lane. We do have the Juggernaut sitting on, actually still the same amount of lasses as the Mirana. These two players are just, you know, neck and neck about this. Lolico on the top, and he is getting close to this level 6. Should be able to reach that very soon. And let's see, PA, level 6 himself. He's having a good time getting farm. Akila, looks like he's going for like the greedy build into the Deathslayer. So like, you know, he's getting face boot, he's getting a wand, he's getting an Akila, then he will go for the Deathslayer. So a lot of like smaller items to set up for the Deathslayer. But once you have the Deathslayer, you know, your damage output is going to be pretty damn insane. And in the meantime, Jug in the mid lane, and most likely just the casual Yasha pickup very early. You may see an Akila on this guy as well, but I guess they already have one Akila, so you may just like go for a rushed up Yasha instead, just so you don't like double items in your team go to the bottom. And okay, Arthur taking a lot of harassment in the face, he should keep him alive, but the Shadow Ward is doing a lot of work on him as well. We do have Sany barely keeping himself alive. One more hit will do the trick, as that will be enough. Now we do have the Terror Blade very, very low. He does have a Sunder available though, so they have to respect him just a little bit, and that's why you see Sanguine Sharks just backing themselves up. They know that there's no way they can just like freely get that kill. He will just Sunder and then turn it around, get a kill himself. So they back themselves up nicely. And yeah, losing one here in the bottom lane, but that's not too bad at all. But the arrow connects onto the Underlord. The Underlord seems to take a lot of damage here. KT becomes, well, Fortune's End comes out. He was trying to stick up, but nope, that is not going to be happening. They do X mark up on the Warlock as well. Looks like they want to die for Sany as well. They do have that Haste Rune on the Mirana, and they will go in. They will get another two-man double star, so I'm sorry, and that will be enough. Fate City doing a lot of work onto the Terrorblade as well as the Kunkka, but not enough to actually kill him, just enough to, you know, spook them a little bit. 2-for-0 for Tarantula Gaming in this bottom lane as they continue to get kills. They continue getting kills, boys. Alright, so let's take a look at the net worth right now. We can see the Terrorblade is having a slight lead compared to the PA. Jug also a little bit behind us from around us. So those kills have definitely been helping out nicely for the side of Tarantula Gaming. Underlord is ahead of the Nyx though, and the Batarang is getting decent farm. So overall, I would say it's fairly even between the two teams. And like I talked about, like when you think of an AFK farming perspective, you don't really have the greatest farming heroes inside of Tarantula Gaming. Like you have the Mirana and the Terrorblade, who's like the only two heroes that can actually like effectively farm on the map. Whereas Sanguine Sharks, like you have a good, you pretty much every single hero except Sany does have a good way of getting farm. Alright, top lane. Actually, the PA getting jumped on as Lolico with his Vendetta. First use of his ultimate will get a kill here. Keep on Cyberman making a nice rotation. They do bring down the PA. They'd miss the action, sadly, but you know, that was seemingly just a very smooth rotation by the two supports of Tarantula Gaming. We'll see if Sanguine Sharks does something on the map to try and punish this, as that is usually what you are looking for. Okay, they make a heavy rotation for our safe lane. Now we should be looking to do something aggressive on the map, whether it's in the mid lane or the bottom lane. But ganking the Terrorblade is probably not going to be that easy without the lasso having been committed from the Batarang. He doesn't have enough mana to use it just yet, so we'll see what Celery does. He's looking for Blink as the next item, as he's just being full on greed mode on this Batarang. And Underlord in the meantime looking for some arcane boots. Most likely will go for like a mechanism pickup for his team. Nothing too fancy though. Alright, let's see Lolligon, top lane. Akeem boots on him as well. Not really anything too great. He's very, very often just sitting on experience range, not really hitting crease, but just, you know, being there. And, yeah. Yep. So it looks like everyone from Sanguine Sharks is happy about just getting a farm. And let's see, Lolligo is being gone. He does take one crit to the face. But the golem being used as well on Lolligo as a pretty heavy commitment. And sadly, they're not going to be able to bring him down as he got out of that sentry range. So Lolligo will survive. The Fatal Bond's still on him, but there's nothing that is connected to. So he will be fine. He'll go heal up with that shrine. Obviously, you don't get out of the invisibility. So they may be able to do something up here as the two supporters once again making a rotation up here with the golem being committed. That is a very, very hefty commitment. But yeah, well, I guess there's not really any bud here, honestly. Like, you can't really use the golem for too much. You're pushing down the wave. They make rotations. The tower will be fine. Maybe you can farm, like, a camp or two. But that is definitely a very, very big ultimate being used for nothing on the side of Sane. He is not going to be too happy about that. He will send the warlock to the mid lane, to the golem to the mid lane. Not really too sure what it's doing under the tower, though. If they're actually trying to nuke it down, they should be able to do so. And indeed, they will get 100 gold on Impus Mirana. As he's like, well, yeah, thank you very much. I'll take that. Lolligo again, 10 seconds left before he can use another invisibility. They are trying to bring him down. Do they want to go very, very deep for this kill, though? As that is pretty damn deep. You have to go forward. He does have his invisibility available now again, so I don't think they want to do that. Jang is just spamming his spells as much as he can, and Lolligo is dropping down very, very low, as he may have to just take it back. Alright, both jumps are from the Conqueror, though. Nice setup onto the PA. The PA gets taken down as Lolligo with that impale. It's so perfectly for Shkibo to come in with his level 7 Kung and do some work here. Now we have Sane, the next one they want to go on. He's trying to just juke around. He's trying to go for the TP. That will not happen, as Lolligo will stop it with that impale, and they will get a double kill in this top lane. So an early level 6, well, an early level 7, I should rather say, on this Kunga. He comes in, he gets the kills, and this is what I was talking about with the PA as well. Like, sure, it's a great hero, you have a lot of damage output, but you have so much magical burst inside of Tarantula Gaming that, once he gets stunned by something, it's really not going to be that easy to keep this guy alive. And indeed, he did get taken down very easily. You have super greedy heroes inside of Sanguine Sharks, as the Bad Rider have been spending a lot of time in the jungle just farming up as much as he can. He's sitting 1,000 gold away from his blink. The Underlord is trying to get a pipe for his team, so not really a mechanism rush, but just a pipe rush. Makes sense in both ways. Like, a pipe is like a cheaper mechanism, right, when it comes to mana use, and it does the same thing in a lot of ways. Very low. He will be taken down as that burst damage from the Metamorphosis Terrorblade is going to be just enough to kill him. And, well, X marks and all that good stuff, it's very unlikely you're going to get out of that. 1-T1 Town top lane will be taken down, but as I say, that Slashrack gets hit by an impale. Lolligo is dropping a little bit low, will go for the spin, and they're now trying to just disengage themselves. False Promise did get used onto the Oracle. Slashrack will dodge out the arrow. Artis is trying to go in and get a jump onto a Jang, as Jang will just blink himself onto Slashrack. They will disengage. Also, very, very big rotation from the side of Tarantula Gaming, as they're not keen on giving up on towers too early. With the Bad Rider being X marked up Shkibo, with the Ronaldo coming through as well. As they want to take this guy down, they will bring him down as well, as he's not going to escape that fate. Instant four-man smoke coming out as well. They do have the Golem available. They do have all of their major spells available. Sure, maybe the Juggernaut leaking a little bit when it comes to mana to use his armor slash, but he has it available now. He goes in, armor slash comes out onto Lolligo. Lolligo dropping very, very low. Root comes out, and he will be taking down. Let's see. They've got very, very good rotation on the side of Sanguine Shark. Sadly, they don't make it in time to actually stop the tower from being denied. But you get a small kill here on the Conqueror here that has been very annoying to you so far. Instant rotation with the smoke, and you get a bonus kill. So Sanguine Sharks, they're fighting themselves back into the game. They are ahead in terms of net worth and experience still by a little bit. So let's see if they can keep up this pressure. They are trying to push down the Tier 2 tower as well. They know the Terrorblade does not have Metamorphosis available for the time being, but I guess this is going to be enough of the fun. They will just go back, pop the healing ward, and then they will have to make the other ward coming out onto the next assassin. They do have a sentry ward put down, so Lolligo is not able to just get a easy jump on him. They will put down a sentry ward themselves, just making sure that Lolligo will not have to deal with that in the top lane, and that's going to be the end of the aggression. Alright guys, let's see. Ondalor very close to finishing his pipe, as that is going to be a nice item to have. He will probably go for the like pipe into Guardian Grease this game, just, you know, make himself and the team very tanky. We have the Juggernaut almost having the Mental Slaughter completed, Phantom Assassin, 1000 gold to go for that Desolator. The Batrider is nearing into that blink, so a lot of core items will arrive on the side of Sanguine Shark, whereas Tarantula Gaming, they don't really have anything great they're waiting for, except for the Aghanims on the Mirana. It will be out very soon, and that is going to be a very nice power spike. The Terrible Liz trying to go for his own Yasha slash Mantis Star Rush. Wildale taking a lot of damage here, as that Metamorphosis from the Terrible, it does hurt a lot. They're trying to save this T1 tower in the bottom lane, and to do that they have the glorious Underlord, as, you know, spamming his Pit of Malice and Firestorm makes it very, very annoying to push into, as they haven't been able to take one single tower yet inside Tarantula Gaming, something that's very atypical for a Terrorblade lineup. Usually you see like towers dropping down at 3 men, Wildale also coming out onto Lollipop in the backline, both thumbs out. They also could want getting hit with the Batrider as well. The PA getting hit as well. No one dropping down though, as they do survive. Jang gets X marked up. He will be gone on. Sidemana gets a kill on him with that Purifying of Flames. That is going to be a 1-for-2 trade off, as the Terrorblade ends up dying in the meantime in the backline from the Golem use of Saini. So Sharks, they still come out of ahead of that fight. They will now be transitioning this into a push, as they know the Terrorblade does not have Metamorphosis available, and the rest of the heroes need to be backing up the Mirana very, very low. So they will get a T1 tower as well, and it just seems like Sanguine Sharks are just playing this a little bit smoother. And you know, you save your T1 tower, you lose the PA, but that's like a small thing. He doesn't have his BKB yet, so it's always going to be very possible that the PA is going to drop down in the fights and before that BKB is online. So yeah, it's okay, it's worth it. And they do push all the way to the tier 2. Rotations come in from the side of Tarantula Gaming. Now the next assassin is going to be hunting for some kind of jump. Maybe Dale is going to be like the pickoff they can get. We do have them around with that Aghanims available. He's looking for the jump. Lolligo comes in with the Impale available. Dale is going to take a lot of damage here. He does have that put keeping him alive for the time being, but this should definitely be a pickoff. Dale, he will not be surviving this one. Cyberman will get another kill for himself. Suddenly he's sitting on 1000 gold on this Oracle. That's it. That's always nice. They will push down the T1 tower in the bottom lane again, as Tarantula Gaming should be able to finally bring it down, but you have a Terrorblade lineup, and this is like the first tower you get at 18 minutes into the game, whereas all the tier 1 towers on your side is already gone. The tier 2 towers have been taking a decent amount of damage as well, as the one in the top lane is dropping down to half HP. Mid lane got pushed down, bottom lane you took a little bit of damage as well, so you need to be a little bit more precise as Tarantula Gaming, because otherwise they're just going to be overwhelmed with losing so many towers too early. The Mantis style on the Juggernaut makes his life a lot easier. He's going for Maelstrom next, just, you know, value item against Illusionic Heroes, and, you know, heroes, like I said, it's Terrorblade is a hero with, like, huge amounts of armor, so you don't really want to go for, like, a right-click damage item. Having a Maelstrom with magical damage makes a little bit more sense, because, you know, magical damage doesn't really care about armor. Desolator on the PA completed now, so his damage output is going to be a lot better now, and he's going for the BKB next, as that should be his power spike transition. The Batrider with a blink have already made some small plays with it. The Underlord got that pipe completed, so we should see Sharks looking for like big fireman fights now, but at the same time, Tarantula Gaming, they're feeling ready themselves. Yasha Dragonlance on the Terrorblade, they have that Aghanim set on the Mirana as well. They're looking for a jump in, they will go for the Mirana ult, they will go in, they will try and get a jump on the same scene, they will go for the goal, and will get it off, will die trying to though. We do have that root coming out from Dane as well. Pipe will be popped. Doom Slasher dropping very, very low. They have his Omni Slash available, but they're just not able to go in and cut off the first leg of Tarantula Gaming, as they're going to be very healthy sitting here. The Oracle is keeping everyone alive, and sure, the Golem got used, but without Fail Bonds on top of it, and with that Metamorphosis being used, this is not enough damage. The PA goes in, tries to shoot some daggers off onto the tablet. We do have that last coming gun onto the Mixer Staff, will be cancelled by the X-Mark. Another back row will be taking a lot of damage, will be taken down, as the Terrorblade is just doing too much, but he gets jumped, he gets killed by Jang instantly with a double crit, as that is going to be a very, very dead Terrorblade. We do have a TP out from the Mirana, sadly not happening, as there's a little bit too much damage between the Jug as well as the PA. They will bring down the two calls of Tarantula Gaming, as it looked a little bit annoying, but you know, if you get a good jump on the Terrorblade, again, just, you have the Sunder, but it's like, you know, You had to be so quick about using your thunder, because you take one crit in the face and suddenly you're like on 200 HP and you're like, oh shit, oh shit, oh shit, I had to thunder. And then you end up dying. God damn. Alright, now that will be an Aegis inside of Sharks, as well as you take two very, very big kills, you get an objective, and then that is the way to move forward, right? You have the Jug being ahead of the Terror Blade, the PA is neck and neck with the Terror Blade, and overall it just seems like every single hero is getting further ahead from the side of Sharks, and they have better heroes at scaling as well. Like, it's a lot easier for these heroes to get farm on the map. And their scaling is very, very strong as well. The Terror Blade is going to be annoying, but he's not going to be unbeatable. Like, they definitely have the ways to deal with him. They're itemizing to deal with him with that Maelstrom on the Jug. And the PA will maybe even consider getting something like a Battle Fury at some point in the game if the Terror Blade becomes too big of an issue. But for the time being, you know, it's working out. It's fine. They don't have to worry too much. Beyond the Lord is sitting on 1500 gold as well, so he could slowly move into that mechanism pickup. The Warlock probably won't get anything big this game, as this is a position 6 Warlock, just buying all the wards to give out your celery space to get his 4 staff and blink and all of these good items on the Batrider. And let's see. Celery moving forward, trying to find some kind of initiation. Let's see if he can scout out something as he's in this. He's smoked up. He's looking for a kill. We do have everyone gathered here from the side of Tantula Gaming, though, as they're looking to smoke up themselves with that smoke on the Oracle. So smoke on smoke action, potentially. Oracle will get squatted out. He will be lassoed up. He will be X-Mark being used on the Oracle, actually, though. So nice move from Skeever, that keeping him away from that lasso. The Nyxus doesn't get taken down instantly, though, as they did not see that coming. Omnislash coming out. The Terrible is starting to make his barrage of damage, but the Murano's also dead. The Underlord is surviving in the background. Shang Yad is being slowed up so much by that upheaval. He's not able to move. He just has to stand his ground and fight. We have Slash Strike. Kung Fu Spin barely surviving up against that Terror Blade. And for some reason, he's still living. I guess that is just going to be the Aegis, but not even being able to take down the Aegis is very, very painful for the side of Terran's full of game. We do have Shkiba in the backline trying to get to survive himself, but it looks like this guy will be taken down as well. That is going to be a full 5-man team wipe, as Tarantula Gaming, they get overwhelmed there. They go in, you use your spells to save the Oracle, but instantly you lose the Nyx in the meantime. You lose the Terror Blade very quickly, as the damage output from the Sharks is just too much. And now we do have the ultimate coming out from the Underlord, just quickly getting into the mid lane so they can abuse these couple of seconds where there's not a lot of heroes left on the side of Tarantula Gaming. They will take that tier 2 tower down in a very, very good speed. We'll see Lolligon will take a little bit of damage. In the meantime, he is invisible. He's ready to go, but I don't know if you can actually go on anything here. Do we have the arrow coming up? Just hitting onto one of the creeps, nothing too fancy. And Sharks will back themselves up. They'll pick up the next set of items. We have the Underlord actually buying sentries for the team, buying wards and sentries for the team. And as the others is like, the Batrider is like, I want to have my 4 staff. And the Warlock is like, I want to have my Midas. So Dale is like, sure guys, I'll buy wards, no problem. I don't need my mechanism anyways. And let's see. Jokinon most likely will upgrade the Mjolnir as the next item. 3000 gold on him after all. BKB complete on the PA. So the trouble that we're online from the side of Tarantula Gaming a second ago is not going to be any easier, as the items is flowing out from the side of Sharks. Like, you have a Blink being picked up by the Murana. The Nyx has his Aconyms very soon. The Terror Blade will have that Mantis Lock completed. But I don't really feel like the fighting power from Tarantula Gaming is going to increase that much, like, in the next couple of items. Whereas Sharks, they just, you know, they just, like, checking off their bucket list one by one, getting this item, that item, this item, that item. So if you have trouble killing them now, then it's going to continue being more and more difficult to do. Especially with the PA, because like the PA's problem is surviving against the Nyx Murana damage and the Kunkka, but you now have the BKB, so you have the solution for all of these things. So PA can be a little bit more like in your face. He can be as aggressive as he wants to without having to be punished by it. And let's see the Warlock. He is actually just going in for the rushed up Aconym, so he doesn't really want to bother getting a Midas. I guess it is fairly late in the game for getting a Midas anyways. Like, you would have it up in a few minutes, and then, you know, it's 27 minutes into the game. You're probably not looking to go for, like, a 60-minute game as Sanguine Sharks. So, just, you know, getting value stats now seems logical. It's also pretty important that the Warlock survives in the fights, at least for like the initial burst. If you can survive through the boat, you know, you get your Golem off, you get your fatal bonds off, then you've done your job. So you really want to be able to do that lolly going to the top lane. It's looking just coming out some kind of initiation. He will jump on to the bad rider. The bad rider taking a lot of damage. Shadow Warrior comes out, and now he's gonna get hunted here. We do have the arrow flying out, and the arrow will connect as Imba will get a nice little kill here. We did have the golem being played around where they could go for the golem. Do they want to? No, they will. Oh, Sane is like, I'm gonna go. Nope. Oh, no. It's just a bait, guys. Nice arrow from Imba, securing a kill for his team. And let's see, he's going for travel boots next. So it seems like Tarantula Gaming, they're content with just dodging fights for the time being, as they definitely need to get some alone time. They need to scale. They need to perhaps look for some more pickoffs with this Nyx Assassin, and then just abuse the fact that Nyx Assassin with Axe is going to be a very, very good, base defending mechanism. The Oracle is going to get a little bit of farm here as well, and yeah, we'll see how much they can hold us. They have, like I talked about earlier, taken a lot of damage already. They only have one tier 2 tower left standing, and that is on 180 HP, so it is about that time where you can start losing shrines, and without the shrines, you lose map control so easily. So yep. Dale does have a 4 staff now completed, so he went for the, initiation type of thing. 4 stuff is always a good item to have. I would probably just go for mech myself, but it's like, okay, well, we can tank up, we can get some kind of positioning item that can make it easier to dodge out the boats as well, and dodging out the Nyx Assassin spells, etc. So, 4 stuff is definitely still a very nice item to have for your team. Plus, no one has a 4 stuff yet outside of Shark, so, someone gotta be the first one, right? The PA has the Skull Basher completed. Nice little upgrade there. Bashes doesn't matter too much this game. At least not against the Terrorblade, because in many cases you're gonna spend time hitting the illusions. But if you get a lucky bash when you have the Abyssal Blade completed, you can get that like jump with an Abyssal Blade stun. You make Terrorblade's life very, very difficult. And in the meantime, the Terrorblade is still sitting on 1500 HP, not too much to work with. As we've seen every single time Jan gets a jump on him, it doesn't take more than like one or two hits before the Terrorblade is down on like 1/3 HP, if not less. We can see that Kunga is also trying to scale into a Rectlick, as he's actually looking for an Omelette pickup. So he's like, okay, well, I gotta do something in this game. We can't just let everything be on the Terrorblade. We have to all scale into some kind of damage output, and the Kunga is going for an Omelette for that purpose. I guess it makes sense. Like the Mirana with the old meta get a lot of magical burst damage build is going to be nice, but you need something else. Like the Terrorblade needs to be the one killing the Juggernaut in like 9 out of 10 cases. The Mirana will not be able to do so with this build, so we need someone else to help along the way. And now the Jug does have his Scotty complete as well, so good tankiness upgrade there as well. You could be looking for Lingens here as well, just to dodge out the Sunder from the Terrorblade, but I guess that's not really too much of a worry for that team, so they'll just tank up naturally. Scotty, very, very good upgrade. Obviously, slowing the Terrorblade is always a nice thing, and with the changes to how like all of these items work, the Scotty, the Maelstrom, and whatnot, you can have all of these items with each other, They no longer, it's no longer like stacks, as in no unique attack modifiers here. Okay, the Juggernaut goes in, gets hit by an arrow, and takes a barrage of Star Stones in the face, and instantly drops down. As that is a very, very painful thing inside our Sanguine Sharks. They may also be losing that next hero. Zhang and Dale will go for the getaway train with the ultimate. They will get themselves out, but still a double kill to Imba, as an arrow is all they needed. They just needed to set up for that kill, and the Juggernaut will be taken down. They did like 60 damage to that tower in that little push, 55 damage to be exact. Painful, painful, painful jump. That's always the good thing with Mirana, right? If you get a good arrow, then it's usually enough to get a kill. The Jug is not that difficult to burst down if you can like you land all of your magical burst spells on him. Same thing for the PA. Usually that is not going to be happening though because of the BKB slash spin, but if you get an arrow that lasts for a long time, then that is definitely going to be a lot more likely. You do see the Underlord now being controlled up. He does have that X mark on him. Good, the arrow flying out as well. They will be able to control him a little bit. Force off comes up from the Bat Runner. keeping him a little bit further away from this annoying lineup of Tarantula Gaming. And he's the one with the pipe. He doesn't take too much damage from that burst of the Mirana. You can see he's still very healthy. We do have Tarantula Gaming now looking for getaway. Everyone will be TPing home. And everyone should get themselves out of here, as I don't think they have much chase potential. Do have the Battle of Willa Gem, though, as he's looking for some kind of initiation. The Shrine will be used. Sandy will be walking himself back and forth. The Roshan is now going to be the next item, that the next thing they go for. That's that illusion. Then we'll spot out the fact that Roshan is being gone on, and let's see what they do. Tarantula Gaming, they're moving themselves towards the pit, but the Roshan is already so low, they get a lot of crits with that PA, and they should be able to take down the Roshan, and that is indeed going to be a lost situation from the side of Tarantula Gaming. They'll back themselves up, they know this is not going to be happening. Nice pit of malice there from Dale, just keeping these peasants away. Keeping all them peasants away, and Sharks, once again, they do have that Aegis advantage. The Underlord is looking for Shiva's got a very big upgrade to him. And obviously AoE is slow against all of those terrible illusions is always nice to have. The Batrider is looking for BKB himself. Very greedy upgrade for him, but I guess it's like, you know, the terrible is the one getting the teamfight items, and he's the one just getting, like, personal items that make him able to do his job. Because against Nyx Assassin and Oracle and Kunk and whatnot, like, it's difficult to do your job efficiently as a Batrider, but he's trying, he's going to try. Alright, he will actually get picked off here. That's a very, very big jump as he's trying to deward. But in the meantime, Tarantula Gaming, they were all in position. They went in, they got the jump. We do have that dust being popped on the Nyx Assassin. We just go into the ground, power up, but no Golem gets popped. A lot of it will be taken down. That is going to be one man down the ground. Who actually picked up the gem? Did anyone pick it up? Yeah, the Mirana will have it. We'll check, they're taking a lot of damage as well here. Force comes is up on him. He does have a ton of vehicle as well. Slash Dog will be fought again. The Sunder comes out onto Dale, and let's see, Slash Dog is very low, but the damage on the Terra Blade, they did so much damage through that Foolish Promise that he went from like full HP to zero. So even though the Sunder gave you a little bit of HP, if you get one shot, then you know that doesn't really help you too much. So that is going to be a dead Terra Blade. The Kunga is spotted in the trees as well. Slash Dog needs to be a little bit careful here. He doesn't want to drop down, even though he does have that HP, he's going around to waste it. And we'll go for a little panic spin. He will survive though, as that is going to be three people dead on the side of Tarantula Gaming for that Batrider kill. They do still secure the gem, but that's a very costly gem to take. Very costly gem, and now it's going to be all about that high ground push. The golem is going to hit a couple of times before disappearing, and Mirana takes a skull bash that comes to the face. And let's see, the tier 3 tower should be taken now. The other lasso coming out from the background, not using any other spells, it doesn't get stunned by that spike carapace. And a double crit from Jiang will nail that Nyx to the ground, as that is going to be a rack secured. No buybacks coming out inside of Tarantula Gaming. They only have the Terra Blade buyback available, and it looks like they just, you know, they just contend with the situation. They know that this is not going to be defendable. They will shoot on the arrow, will hit onto Jiang. They're trying to burst him down, but that healing wall is being a very, very annoying thing. Jiang still surviving, Shadow War keeping him alive and whatnot. Jiang. Okay, the other boat coming out, that could be painful as Jank does get, oh, he does get a jump away, doesn't get a hit by the boat actually, does have his BKB still available, may have to use it, but you know, a nice blink strike away will mean that he does not have to use that. And in the meantime, Skeeper going in, trying to secure some kind of kill here, as they don't want to just give up on everything, but upheaval being used, Firestorm being used, all these annoying spells, like, they're not gonna commit for a kill, they will still just let them go. They will just let them go. Alright, so Terrorblade will have enough gold to pick up his Scotty now. Good upgrade when it comes to tankiness, but it just feels like, you know, you get another tank item, even if you get a butterfly, you need to get an MKB, blah blah blah. Like, his damage output is great, but if they jump him, if they Omni Slash him, if the PA gets like a lot of damage output onto him, the Terrorblade is just dropping down every time. Sunder is a nice spell, but like I said, you know, if you get Foolish Promise and then you end up dropping down like toward, like through the Foolish Promise, like full HP, it's just, that's how much damage that you have on the side of Shark. So I don't think this Terra Blade is actually ever going to be that scary. No matter what type of items you get, the PA is always going to do a lot of damage. The Juggernaut is doing an incredible amount of damage with that Mjolnir and Scotty being online. I imagine he will go for like a butterfly next himself, just so he can, you know, survive better himself as well. PA with the Abyssal Blade. And as a PA, I guess next step would be, would that also be a Scotty? Like Scotty, Lingen Sphere perhaps? to see. Lolico, let's go in, get a jump on the Juggernaut that will talk out ages, but at what cost? As now they will be hunted down, the gem is up on the Batterer. They do see Otto, they find him, they get a jump, Lazo comes out, he gets Omni Slash instantly, and he will be taken down as Yargo gets killed in the meantime by Jang, just going in and getting like some kind of one-shot dagger off, and that is two people dead inside of Tarantula Gaming, as a lot of damage was lost there. Value was lost. You know, you pop in ages, but hardly worth losing your safe lane carry forward. And keeping in mind, he doesn't have any buyback available, so the 40 seconds they have to work with is going to be very, very nice from the side of Sharks. That may actually just be a side of Rax being lost in the mid lane as well, as 30 seconds should be enough time to bring down that Rax. I don't think they have fortification available just yet. Okay, they do have one up. And let's see, they're working on it. 20 seconds to go. Boat comes out, they're trying to buy themselves some time, but they're just spinning away from Slashrack. He will still take range back. They will go from there as well, as they realize that Terrible does not have his buyback available. And that is going to be one side taking down. Jang will get a little bit of feeling in the meantime. The golems will finally drop down. As that was Akinim's golems, by the way, ready for that fight. So obviously a nice upgrade for the Warlock as well. Shiva's guard is up and completed on the Underlord now as well. So a lot of big items. Batrider's almost having enough gold for his BKB as well, and well, two sets of racks down on the side of Tarantula Gaming, as there's only one set of racks left to go. The next first round will respawn in anything between a few minutes and 5 minutes, but it's looking grim. It's looking very grim from the side of Tarantula. They have, you know, they have a gem. Omelette is almost done in the Conquer, but I don't feel like there's any one item they can get that can change the way this game is going. The Mirana with the Ethereal Blade and Dagon build is going to do some damage, but it's not a lot. Terrorblade as well, you know, he has the Scotty, Mantis, Stall, Dragonlance. It will take him a while before he actually becomes a scary force to be reckoned with, though. And let's see, 20,000 lead inside of Sharks right now. Also, when it comes to network, what's it called, experience. So we'll see if Tarantula Gaming can find some kind of magical formula to get an initiation off that works. Because at this point, I feel like what I talked about in the draft, that is the issue. They don't have any initiation type of hero. And the Nyx Assassin was forced into building an Akinith because they had such a rough early game. So what do you even do here? Like, do you walk at the enemy team with the Nyx and try and get some kind of jump on the Jug or the PA? That just seems unlikely. Like, you're not going to get away with this, like, walking off the people. You need to blink initiate, get a stun off, get a quick pick off, and then, you know, work your way around that one big pick off. But it doesn't seem like that will ever happen from Tarantula Gaming. Like, you don't have anyone who can jump. So unless they get, like, a huge arrow from Imba, I don't think they can win that fight. And we'll see if that is definitely going to be true. Sharks, they're just moving themselves around. They'll take down the shrine slowly. As, you know, they're waiting. They're just waiting for the Roshan. There's no hesitation coming out from them. They will get the next set of items. The PA will pick himself up an MKB. Is, I guess he just decided that, you know, he wants more damage. He doesn't really care too much about his survivability, and the Terrorblade will at some point get a butterfly, so it's like, you might as well just get an MKB. Like, who cares about what other item you want? Might as well just get some value damage that you will not have to replace at some point. Slashstrike does have his basher complete now as well. He's looking for an Abyssal Blade. Underlord, not really showing us just yet what he wants to go for. I imagine he will go for the Greaves in the end, just so he doesn't have to replace any slots. The Batrider, you know, just having fun with that BKB now being done as well. The Warlock is looking for Refresher Orb, as a very expensive item for Saini, but, you know, slowly and surely he should be able to make his way there. He does have the Akinims already, so if they keep on getting good kills, that may happen. Armlet is done now on the Conquer and whatnot. Gets a quick takeoff onto the Underlord, not able to get his hype off in time, but the Mirana with a leap away, not getting onto the high ground. He will be picked off as a cost for that thing, as, you know, committing the goal and whatnot is always going to be worth it for getting that Mirana kill. Dale barely surviving that one, but it's a tanky hero, you know. even though he didn't get his pipe off, like, it's still 2,000 HP you need to get through, and, well, 2,000 HP with a lot of magic immunity with the resistance, obviously, 30% resistance, so you need to do roughly, like, 3,000 magical burst damage as some runner to kill him, and that's not there yet, you know? You have your star, double star, triple star storm, I guess, you hit 3 star storms, Ethereal Blade, Dagon, it's a lot of magical damage, but just barely not enough, and now will Lollygirl be spotted out, will be lassoed out, will be dragged back, more from some sort of trying to keep him alive, he will start walking from away, but he's taking a lot of damage, and he will just drop down instantly, I imagine, as indeed he will. If Retail is not dropping down, that is going to be the last set of racks they're fighting for, as the BKB should run out on Jang very, very soon. Lollygirl is looking for an initiation. The Terrible is coming in from the side, trying to do whatever damage he can. Slashback will go through the sprint. That is on the side really. You need to be careful. You don't want to lose your jump before getting the spin out. Oh, he gets the Thunder Slash off fairly with 70 HP left. Artis will go for the Sun onto Dale onto that Underlord. He will survive and he will get the kill on the Juggernaut, but now he's low himself. Fatal Bond comes out and he does not have any Sun available just yet, so now he will be taken down as they finally bring down that big boy. We do have Imbicum Coin getting a nice. And getting a nice Star Storm off, they will bring down the PA triple buyback from Sharks as they're like, okay boys, we're doing it. We will Underlord all, we'll go back in, we'll end the game now as they know they're in a position to do so. There's no buybacks on everyone from inside of Tantula Gaming, so this is now 5 versus 3 as the Terrible will be falls into a buyback. There's no racks left standing on the side of Tantula Gaming. They'll finish that off very, very quickly. They had to commit buybacks for this, but that should still be worth it. As the Warlock will not be picked off in the backlines. A little quick constellation press on the side of Tarantula Gaming. They're still surviving, they're still in the game, but as long as Sharks can weather the storm, weather the effects of those buybacks, they should still be very pleased with what happens. You know, costly buybacks, but I don't think it's possible for them to be punished. Like, cause in a normal situation, right? Okay, you commit buybacks on every single call. You go in, you get your melee, you get your racks taken down, and then if they get wiped, then they will lose the game instantly. But they are in this position where you still have tier 2s in every single lane, so even if they got killed, it's very unlikely that Tarantula Gaming will be able to push them all the way to the rack before they respawn. Obviously, they get a pickup on the next assassin, and Rana will be dragged into the pit as he does not have his false promise stand nearby. He will get the false promise off finally, but Rana gets patched up by the PA, and looks like this guy will be taken down in the end, as indeed. Slashdrag will be the one getting the kill. We do have Roshan being worked at. GG will play gets called as they know. Without the Nyx, without the Mirana, Mega Creeps hunting them in the base, there's no way that they win this game. And Tarantula Gaming, they will be dropping out. The Sharks, they move on further and they will be facing up against Horde next in just a minute, guys.